If you hear someone drop the word Kubernetes at a meetup and you nod along like you totally get it, but inside you are like, is that a new Greek dish? Well, today we are serving up Kubernetes 101. No geek speak, no fluff, just the juicy bits. Grab your favorite snacks and let's dive in. The big problem. Imagine this. You've built the next big app, let's say an AI that translates baby talks into adult language. Parents are going wild. But then, boom, your server's melting like ice cream on a hot day. Total chaos. Who do you call? Kubernetes to the rescue. But hold on, what is Kubernetes? In simple terms, it's like the traffic cop for your app containers, ensuring everything runs smoothly in the wild cloud. Wait, back up a second. What is a container? Containers are not just for shipping. Think of it as a box that holds everything your app needs to run. Code, runtime, system tools, you name it. It's like packing a lunchbox with your favorite snacks. No surprises, no missing cookies. Kubernetes makes life easier. Now, juggling a few containers? Easy peasy. Juggling thousands? That's like herding cats hopping up on a catnip. Enter Kubernetes. It automates deployment, scaling, and management so that you can kick back and sip that latte. Docker Swarm is easier to set up, but lacks the advanced scheduling and scaling capabilities Kubernetes offers. Nomad is more lightweight, but doesn't have the wide community supports or ecosystem integration of Kubernetes. Kubernetes has some killer features. Self-healing. If a container goes down, Kubernetes is like, not today, buddy, and spins up a new one. It's the Hydra of the tech world. Load balancing. It spreads traffic evenly so no single container gets hammered. Rollouts and rollbacks. It deploys new versions without downtime. If things go south, roll back smoother than a Michael Jackson moonwalk. Why should you care? Here is the kicker. Kubernetes lets you deploy applications anywhere. On premises, in the cloud, under your bed. Okay, maybe not there. But you get the idea. It's the ultimate wingman for your apps. Getting started without losing your mind. Now I know that you are thinking this sounds complex, but getting started is easier than the time you tried to assemble IKEA furniture without the manual. Tools like Minikube lets you run Kubernetes locally. With a single command, Minikube start, you can spin up a local cluster. More on that later. The Kubernetes community rocks. Stuck on something? The Kubernetes community is massive and super friendly. Jump into forums, Slack channels, Discord, you name it. There is always someone who's got your back. Kubernetes architecture. All right, I've talked a lot about the why of Kubernetes, but let's get down to the how. Building blocks of a cluster. First off, let's talk about the brains and brawn of Kubernetes, the cluster. Imagine Kubernetes as a city. In this city, you've got roads, traffic lights, and vehicle moving around. Well, in Kubernetes, this vehicle are pods, your app containers running in harmony. At the heart of this city are nodes, the workers that actually do the heavy lifting. Each node can host multiple pods, and the collection of nodes makes up a cluster. It manages everything that happens. Core components, deployments, replica sets, and more. Now, to manage all these pods and nodes, Kubernetes uses a few key components. You've got deployments and replica sets. Deployments define the desired state of your app, like how many pods you want running, while replica sets ensure the right number of pods is always active. When you deploy a pod, Kubernetes doesn't just slap it onto a node randomly. It carefully schedules pods based on resource availability. This ensures each node has the capacity to handle the low. Quads go through phases like bending, running, succeeded, and failed. And understanding this helps when debugging issues. If a pod crashes, Replica Set steps in to spin up another one. You've also got config maps and secrets, which allow you to manage environment variables and sensitive data like passwords without hard coding them into your app. It offers robust tools like role-based access control, or RBAC, and pod security policies to ensure only authorized users can deploy and modify services and that containers run with the least privilege needed. Networking and load balancing, traffic control. Next up, networking. Kubernetes uses services to expose your app to the outside world, kind of like opening the gates to let traffic flow in and out. There are different types of services depending on what you need. Cluster IP, node port, and load balancer. And if you are dealing with external traffic from users, you will need an ingress controller. This guy handles HTTP and HTTPS traffic, rolling users to the correct services inside your cluster. It's like the bridge that connects your app to the big, wide internet. To prevent any service from hogging all the resources, Kubernetes allows you to set resource quotas. These quotas ensure that workloads share resources fairly. Also, don't forget about monitoring. Tools like Prometheus integrate seamlessly to help you track container health. Helm Charts, the package manager for Kubernetes. Helm is a way to easily define, install, and upgrade even the most complex Kubernetes apps. In one command, you can deploy a whole slack of services. It's like setting up databases, web servers, and caching layers all in a single swoop. Stateful versus stateless applications. While Kubernetes is often used for stateless services like web servers that can be scaled easily, it also supports stateful applications through Stateful Set. This is perfect for databases or applications where the order and persistence of data are key, such as in distributed databases or file systems. Storage. Kubernetes handles storage through persistence volumes, or PV, and persistent volume claims, PVC. This ensures your data sticks around even when a pod is deleted. For example, if you are running a database, you wouldn't want to lose your data every time a pod is restarted. Kubernetes ecosystem tools. Kubernetes integrates into a broader DevOps pipeline thanks to its vast ecosystem. Prometheus and Grafana are dynamic duo for monitoring the health of your services. Post-service mesh and managing microservice communication, Istio or Linkerd make sure your services talk smoothly to one another while keeping them secure. Minikube versus Kind versus managed Kubernetes services. The difference between Minikube, Kind, and managed Kubernetes services like Google Kubernetes Engine and Amazon Elastic Kubernetes Service comes down to the scale, purpose, and environment in which you are working with Kubernetes. Here is a breakdown to help you understand the differences and decide which one to use. Minikube. Minikube runs in a single node Kubernetes cluster in your local machine. It's designed primarily for learning, development, and testing Kubernetes in a local environment. Use case. Local development and experimentation with Kubernetes. It's great for developers who want to quickly test Kubernetes applications on their laptops without needing a full cloud setup. Advantages. It's easy and fast to set up on local machines. It runs in lightweight virtual machines or container, so it's low overhead. There is no cost since it runs on your local resources. As limitation, it's a single node cluster, so it doesn't fully simulate a multi-node production-like environment. It's limited to local resources like RAM and CPU, so it can't handle large-scale workloads. Kind. Kind stands for Kubernetes in Docker, and it lets you run Kubernetes clusters inside Docker containers. Like Minikube, it's primarily for local development and testing, but Kind can simulate multi-node clusters on your local machine. Use case. It's ideal for local Kubernetes testing, especially for continuous integration and continuous development pipelines, because it's lightweight and fast. It can also simulate more realistic environments by running multiple nodes, making it a better choice for testing complex Kubernetes configurations. Advantages. It simulates multi-node clusters, unlike Minikube. It's easy to set up on continuous integration, continuous deployment pipelines for testing. It runs also entirely within Docker, so it doesn't require a full virtual machine setup. Limitation. It's still a local setup, so it's not meant for production workloads. It's limited by your local machine's resources, which can become an issue with larger workloads. Managed Kubernetes services. Managed Kubernetes services, such as Google Kubernetes Engine, Amazon Elastic Kubernetes Service, and Azure Kubernetes Service, are cloud-based platforms that handle most of the Kubernetes infrastructure for you. The services take care of things like cluster provisioning, scaling, and upgrades. They allow you to focus on deploying and managing your applications. Use case. Best suited for production workloads, large-scale applications, and teams that want to offload infrastructure management to the cloud. This is ideal when you are ready to move from development, testing, into production environment, or need to scale beyond local resources. Advantages. Automatic scaling, updates, and maintenance are offered by the cloud provider. There is also multi-node clusters that can scale up and down based on demand. High availability and disaster recovery capabilities. Access to cloud-specific integrations like storage, networking, security features from GCP, AWS, or Azure. Limitations. Cost. You will pay for the clusters and associated cloud resources like nodes, load balancers, etc. It's slightly more complex to set up and manage compared to local solutions, though cloud providers simplify this a lot. It's an overkill for small-scale development or testing, where local solutions like Minikube or Kind would suffice. Getting your hands dirty. Enough theory. Time to get your hands dirty. So how do you go from hearing Kubernetes buzzwords to actually deploying apps on it? Stick with me, because this part is where the magic happens. Spin up your own cluster. Here is how to set up your very own Kubernetes cluster locally, so you can start playing around without worrying about breaking anything important. First off, install Minikube or Kind. These are tools that let you run Kubernetes right on your laptop. It's like setting up a mini cloud in your backpack. Let's use Minikube for this demo. I have a MacBook Pro, so I used Brew to install it by running the command brew install Minikube. Then just run Minikube start. Okay, remember that Minikube runs on a virtual machine or a container. I don't want to set up a virtual machine, so I need to start Docker desktop first. Then just run Minikube start. And you've got yourself a Kubernetes cluster. Now you can go to the Docker desktop. There, under the Images view, you will see the image for Kubernetes Minikube. Under Volumes, you will see the associated Minikube volume, and you will find the Minikube container under the Containers view. You can click on it and check the content of the different tabs there. So, there you have it, Kubernetes in a nutshell, or should I say, in a container. Now you are no longer just hearing about Kubernetes, you are using it. And trust me, this is just the tip of the iceberg. The more you practice, the more you will see how Kubernetes can be your superpower for managing containerized applications and hopefully getting better jobs. Found that helpful? Smash that like button like it's a bug in your code. Don't forget to subscribe for more tech insights. Got questions or topic you would love to unravel? Drop a comment below. Until next time, keep the servers running and that coffee brewing.
Excited about diving deeper into the world of software architecture? This video is just the beginning. Check out my Udemy video course on software architecture. The link to the course is in the video description below. See you next time.